Laboratory X-19, also known as the Brain Scorcher, this lab is surprisingly very quiet, giving the place an eerie and mysterious atmosphere. Much like every secret lab, a load of questions surround the facility. When was it built? Why was it built? And how is the Brain Scorcher machinery working? Hello, stalkers, and welcome to the Anomalous Dugout. In this video, we will try to answer these questions and more. Before we start, be aware that there will be major spoilers. Also, this video is part of a series, so I suggest you go watch the previous episodes if you haven't already. Link to the playlist in the description. And now, let's take a look at Laboratory X-19 and the Brain Scorcher, starting with its known history. The underground lab is located on top of a hill, in the Red Forest, under an unknown complex that contains the infamous antennas. It is unknown when this facility was built exactly, but if we trust the Sea Consciousness representative, it was constructed after 1989. Also, the representative explained that the Brain Scorcher was turned on after the creation of the zone, in order to stop people from going to its center. So it appears that the installation was used for this purpose only after 2006. In my opinion, the laboratory and the antennas were set up in the 1990s as part of the psi-control experiments, but the machine was not used on a large scale until the Sea Consciousness turned it into the Brain Scorcher, shortly after the appearance of the zone in 2006. Anyway, from the moment the antennas were activated, a large portion of the zone's center was covered in deadly psi emissions, which can turn people into zombies, and possibly recruit members for the Monolith faction as well. This prevented stalkers from exploring places, such as Pripyat, and of course, the nuclear power plant. However, it is known that some people, such as the legendary Strelok, who used underground tunnels, managed to bypass the Brain Scorcher and go to Pripyat and the sarcophagus. Therefore, it is likely that the area of influence created by the Brain Scorcher is more like a ring, and its inner parts are not covered in psi emissions. Moreover, I believe that psi emissions behave a bit like sound waves, in the sense that they are affected by terrain, and cannot fully go through certain materials. This would explain why Strelok could use an underground passage to avoid the emissions, and why these emissions are not present inside Lab X-19 itself, despite the fact that it's located right below the antennas. If that's correct, it would also make sense to build the facility on top of a hill, so that the antennas can easily emit to all the territories around. Also, it is mentioned several times in the games that psi emissions have an intermittent nature, which means that sometimes the emissions are very powerful, and sometimes they are much weaker. According to the Marked One himself, the power is regularly lowered in order to cool down the machines. We saw in the last video that the Psi emitter in Lab X-16 had problems with its cooling system, so it is possible that the Brain Scorcher had similar issues as well. But we'll talk about that a bit later. To finish with the history of the area, the lab was raided by Strelok himself between May and August 2012, and he deactivated the antennas, successfully opening the way to the central parts of the zone. After the Brain Scorcher was shut down, the facility was also targeted by the Ukrainian military. It is unknown if the special forces did manage to capture the complex, and if they held on to this position. So the fate of the antennas and Lab X-19 after the events of Shadow of Chernobyl remains a mystery for now. Most likely we'll see how things turned out in Stalker 2. Alright, now that we saw the history of the location, let's talk about the layout of the area, starting with its exterior. As I said already, the main facility is located on top of a hill, and that's where the antennas are found. However, there are other interesting structures found in other parts of the Red Forest. First of all, we have what appears to be the entrance of an underground bunker. I've spoken about this door before, but in case you don't know, this used to be the real entrance to the Brain Scorcher lab in old builds of the game. Ultimately, the entrance was moved directly under the antennas, but this door remained, leaving us to speculate about its new purpose. It could be another entrance of Lab X-19, or maybe the door to a completely different underground facility. Who knows? Then there is this unknown contraption next to the road. It looks like a concrete corridor, or maybe it is some sort of pipeline, I'm not sure. In any case, it is possible to access a small room located inside, but the other doors are closed. Perhaps it is a way to connect Lab X-19 to the other facility that might be located behind the previous door. Well, if you have any theories of your own about this, make sure to comment them under the video. And now let's get back to the antennas themselves. Designated as a rainbow emitter, or Kamenov emitter, in secret documents, these five antennas do not appear to be extremely complicated contraptions. They are simple frames of metal, each connected to the ground by four pairs of metal wires. The antennas are powered up by a vertical electric cable inside a protective sheet, which goes through three different electric boxes before reaching the top. Also, it is important to notice that two of the antennas are also directly connected to high voltage lines coming from the nearby towers. Furthermore, it is possible to find a strange device at the base of each antenna. These machines look like the Psi devices found in Call of Pripyat, so they are likely to be involved into the production of the Psi emissions. Finally, we can notice that one of the antennas is damaged and not working. We don't know how it was broken, but it is possible that problems with the cooling system were responsible for the malfunction. In fact, an out-of-control rise in temperature could have melted some parts of the metallic structure, causing the antenna to tilt. But this is just speculation. Well, that's it for the antennas themselves, so it's time to go down into the lab and see what interesting things we can find there. Despite the numerous monolith soldiers defending the antennas, and the fact that the Brain Scorcher is very important to them, the laboratory itself appears to have been abandoned for quite some time. We can see clear signs of degradation, such as damaged ceilings, collapsed hallways, and of course, rusting machinery. Besides, the lab is home to a few bloodsuckers that might or might not be responsible for the three skeletons scattered in the area. Since the door to X-19 is unlocked, I believe that these bloodsuckers came from the exterior and were not directly created in the lab. This is backed up by the fact that I could not find any traces of experiments on living creatures, unlike in the other labs that we explored in previous videos. However, I did notice a few elements that we can link to what we saw in the other labs. First of all, there is a small pool near the entrance, where you can find the first skeleton. This reminded me of the toxic pool in X18, and the pools in the cells in X16. But maybe this one was used for something different, who knows. Secondly, X19 is filled with pipes, tubes, barrels and tanks. Only this time, I'm really not sure what they are supposed to contain. If you remember, in the preceding episodes, we speculated that such systems were used to store and move around unknown chemical substances that were used during the experiments. Most likely, these chemicals were connected to the creation of mutants and biological psi-emitters, such as the one in X16. Yet, in the case of the Brain Scorcher, the emitters appear to be completely non-organic. Therefore, my first assumption was that the tanks and tubes were part of the machine's feeding and cooling systems. But then, I noticed something really strange. Many of the tanks here are equipped with a gauge, which I assume is used to indicate the pressure of the fluid inside. And to my surprise, every single one of these gauges was showing the same thing. Zero. No pressure. Nothing. Of course, this is a very small detail that perhaps the developers did not pay attention to, but I don't really believe in such a coincidence. To me, this can only mean one thing. None of these systems are working. How is the Brain Scorcher still functioning then? Well, I have a few theories. One, these systems are actually not used by the Brain Scorcher, but were part of other experiments in the lab. This is quite unlikely, but it could be the case. Two, these systems do belong to the Brain Scorcher, but they are not essential to its basic functions. It is important to point out that the facility is huge and filled with many locked doors that the player cannot open, which means that some parts of the lab are not accessible. Because of this, it is possible that many other machines are connected to the Brain Scorcher in other parts of the lab, and some of these are still working. If that's the case, this would perhaps explain why one of the five antennas is not working anymore. And three, the machines that we see in the lab are part of the Brain Scorcher's cooling system, which is not working anymore. If you follow the logic of the labs and the Psi experiments, it is obvious that the rainbow emitters from X19 are an evolution of previous devices, including the brain in X16. The Scorcher is the ultimate Psi machine, the last generation that was developed, if you will. So if we consider it as an improved version of X16's biological emitter, then it is natural that X19 would feature a much better cooling system. In fact, I believe that this cooling system was designed to suppress the problems encountered by the former versions, which required phases of decreased power. What I'm trying to say is that originally, the Brain Scorcher would be able to always function at full power, but only if all the installations are working. Of course, we know that it is not the case, and that is why the Brain Scorcher is also forced to reduce its power from time to time to cool down. Anyway, maybe the machines are actually supposed to be working, and my interpretation is wrong. This ventilator is turning, after all. Now, there are a few last things that I want to talk about. I said earlier that the lab was abandoned for a long time and that many doors were locked. Well, in fact, it is possible to find the code for one of the doors, which is held by a monolith master, located near that famous old bunker entrance in the Red Forest. Behind the door, you'll find a lot of supplies. So it appears that it was the monolith faction who made this stash. And finally, there are those two strange red shafts with extreme heat at the bottom. These look like industrial burners, but I'm not entirely sure. Why would the facility need burners? And why are these still hot? Perhaps these were used for the production of vapor, or simply for heating. But all the other systems use electricity, so that's a bit weird. Also, it is possible that the heat comes from a subtype of fire anomaly, which is prone to spawn where a lot of heat used to be located. Moreover, the same heat effect can be experienced in one of the pits in the switch room, but not in both. Is this an indication that one of these columns is still active, but the other is not? I do not have the answer, unfortunately. And so, that's basically it. As you can see, many mysteries still surround Laboratory X-19 and the Brain Scorcher. So, if I missed anything, or if you have any theories or reactions of your own, make sure to share all of that in the comments below. As for now, I thank you very much for watching, Stalkers, and goodbye.